So maybe at the end, we'll see if Matt has some announcements. I know there's some programs coming up here in Lent that I thought he might want to say something. He's got the brochure for September. Here he comes. Matt, did you want to make some announcements?
Sure. On the back table here, I have two flyers. One is for the Passion Relics. Due to the generosity of some donors, the Relic Chapel altars are being repainted. The inner niches are being returned to the red they were meant to be. We will have some of the relics out of the altars. This is not something that happens every day, every month, every year, every decade. But we'll be putting relics on display on Christ's Passion. So you can actually pick up the relic and look into the relic of the crown of thorns and see that thorn in there. The little piece of Aaron's veil, a small chip from the Last Supper table, and a few other relics. So it's kind of a, not calling it once in a lifetime, but really this is a rare opportunity to get to see these up close. So that will be a Sunday evening at 7 o'clock, and I'll keep the chapel open until 9. The other one is Tenebrae. Tenebrae is a very old and ancient part of church's celebration of Holy Week.
The issue isn't that we're not holy enough. The issue is, and to me this is the slapping God a little bit in the face, if you can think about that. You know, God is saying, I'm inviting you. All you need to do is say yes. Here I am. Here I am. And God just keeps giving. We have a much greater sense of sin than God does concerning us. We're not going to worry about sin, I think, than God is. God desires, and Scripture is just filled with this. We'll look at some of those passages shortly. God desires that we begin this loving relationship with God. From the very beginning, what was the Garden of Eden all about? A beautiful passage in Genesis. God would come down in the cool of the evening and walk with Adam and Eve. Isn't that an incredible, incredible reflection? And then dumb Adam and Eve messed it up. Not only for Adam and Eve, it messed up all the rest of us. Because that's where, for the first time, we let human weakness say no, instead of God's desire for us to say yes. But here's the wonderful thing. Adam and Eve would walk with God in the cool of the evening. What an intimate picture, huh? I think God was in between Adam and Eve, hand in hand. You know, just this pleasant, wonderful. The Scripture doesn't tell us what they chatted about. But I suspect it was the beauty of the garden and God's closeness. The wonders that God did for humankind when God created us in God's very image. What does that mean to be created in God's image? It means to be created in holiness. And here's the amazing thing. Here it is. Here it is. We can walk intimately with God. We can chat intimately with God anytime we please. A chapel with the Blessed Sacrament. And then the afternoons here three times, the Blessed Sacrament exposed. You know, there's a kind of an intimacy there. But I never drive up here from Dayton. I sing all the time. All the times that I can remember. And I make up some words when I can't remember. Because when I look around at this beautiful country, how can we not be grateful for the presence of God? Except that when I got and got out of the car and smelled, and I wasn't so sure. Are they fertilizing? It's pretty bad out there. All right, with all of that, I want to begin with an opening statement. God is holy. God is holy. For I am the Lord your God. Now, here's the clinch. Be holy. That's a command. Be holy. For I am holy. It's from the book of Leviticus in the Old Testament. The Hebrew word for that is kodesh. I just put that in to be a smart aleck. Kodesh. And what that is holiness is of the essence of God. Who is God? God is holy. We can't box holiness up. I can't hold it up and say, here is holiness. Holiness is who God is. We cannot see God's holiness, but we can see its manifestation, which is glory. We can see that glory in a sunset. Some of them are getting into the time of year when they're just incredible. I'm usually not up, so I'm not so big on sunrises. But I suspect they're just as gorgeous. We can see God's holiness, God's glory, in the innocent look of a little baby or a little child. And sometimes I see God's glory in that terrible two-year-old who's big, mischievous, and knows it, and is just delighting in making mom and dad frustrated. And it can manifest itself in so many ways. The Hebrew word for glory is Shekinah. It's not on your paper. Shekinah, S-H-E-K-I-N-A-H, if you want to transcribe it into our alphabet and word. Shekinah. That verse 5. Beautiful passage. Moses sees the burning bush. Remove the sandals from your feet. Now, in that culture, that was a sign of respect. For the place on which you are standing is holy ground. It's holy ground because God's presence was there. Now, here's another way I've interpreted that. Remove the sandals from your feet. When we are in the presence of God, we want to remove everything that might get in the way between us and God. So if Moses is standing on holy ground, that burning bush is the glory of God, is the visibility of God's holiness. Remove your, get rid of your sandals, get rid of even that little tiny piece of leather between you and the earth, so that you can actually feel God. If you see a gorgeous sunset, don't you just want to grab it and take it in? And that's what God's presence does to us. It's a wonderful two-way street. We encounter God's holiness in this manifested glory, and we want to embrace it and take it in. But all along, God has already taken us in. So we have a share in God's holiness. So our next one, Isaiah. Chapter 6, verse 3. This is the call of Isaiah the prophet. And as part of the call, Hosea hears, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." We sing this every time we're at Mass or say it, don't we? Now we can stop and think a little bit. The whole earth is full of God's glory. The angels sing this unceasingly in heaven before the divine throne. And when we sing this, we are joining the heavenly host and singing God's praises. And how do we praise God? By acknowledging who God is. Holy, holy, holy. We could translate that.
Thank you.
not as perfectly perhaps, but we don't love differently from God. And when we look at God and the Father and the Son in this perfect love union, there's a Greek word the theologians like to use about this. I love the word. It's called perichoresis. Isn't that beautiful? Peri, through. That's the Greek word for through. Preposition. Choresis, we have an English word that derives from that. Can you guess? Cor, that's not. Nope. C-H-O-R. Choresis. Choreography. What does a choreographer do? Make up dances, construct the structure of dances. So if you go to see a ballet, for example, those ballerinas are not there just doing whatever they want. That's all been choreographed, huh? That's all been worked out. You know, this is how many steps. We had the Olympics not too long ago. The only part that I really enjoy watching are the ice skaters, you know, and the ice dancing. You know, I mean, that's absolutely choreographed to the split second, isn't it? And when he's throwing her around, it better be. So what perichoresis is, it's the dancing through. And that's the word theology uses to describe the love of the Father and the Son. There is so much joy in that love being shared that it's a divine dance. It's a divine dance that the love is so deep, the energy is so strong, that it actually generates the third person of the Blessed Trinity, the Holy Spirit. That's exciting. That's exciting. When I get to heaven, I'm not the most rhythmic person in the world. I don't dance very well, so I refuse to dance. But when I get to heaven, I'm going to dance. I'm going to dance. It's going to be nice. It's going to be beautiful. Because that's what God does. That dance of joy that is a total self-giving to the other. And in God, that is so powerful. That is so life-generating that it actually generates the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Blessed Trinity. We share in that divine dance. Those of you who want to take notes, perichoresis is P-E-R-I-C-H-O-R-E-S-I-S. Perichoresis. You can hear it on YouTube later when you have a panel. Perichoresis expresses the energy, the dynamism, the joy, the movement, the inner penetration of what God's holiness means. That's why I love that word so much. I have to say it. Say it. Perichoresis. It's a bad word. Besides that, nobody else knows it, so we bring that up the table. Alright. Now, I'm going to look at what's come to be called the holiness code in the book of Leviticus, and that's chapter 17 to 26. So you hear that word kadesh throughout these chapters in the book of Leviticus, sometimes called the law book, and it is full of laws, but we kind of shortchange the real power of the book when we only limit it to that. Now, I kind of developed this law code or this holiness code in Leviticus from three different strands. The first strand are religious laws. Now, I want to remind you that religious or religion comes from the Latin religio, which means to bind or to be in relationship. So when we talk about our religion, we often think of the concrete laws of the church and tenets we must understand and all that. But in fact, what religion means is binding us to God in a divine human relationship. That's what that basic word means. So when we're looking at the religious laws in the book of Leviticus, in the holiness code, we're looking for where holiness is opening to us a stronger binding. therefore, and be holy, for I am the Lord your God. What does consecrate mean? Calm with sacredness. So consecrate means to make sacred. We're going to see in a minute what also means. Well, let's go right away. Leviticus 20:26, which is a little later in the same chapter. You shall be holy to me. Well, that's comforting. Huh? You shall be holy to me, for I, the Lord, am holy. The writer of Leviticus is trying to tell us, you're going to share in my very holiness. And I have separated you from the other peoples to be mine. This all goes to the election of Israel as God's chosen people, as God's holy people. God chose Israel, this crazy little dumb band of not very faithful people. Most often didn't choose God very well. Of course, they always got in trouble when they didn't choose God, didn't they? God loved them and chose them. Why? Who knows? I think God makes lots of mistakes in choosing people. I think Jesus didn't choose the best 12 people to be his apostles. Not that any of us would probably do any better. But you see, it goes back to my earlier point. God doesn't look at us and our faithfulness. God doesn't look at us and our abilities. God doesn't look at us and how smart we are. God, for whatever reason, falls in love with us and chooses us. God chooses us. If you don't hear anything else from me today, it happens with us. So the religious laws are really about binding ourselves through consecration, through a sacredness that is so important to us, so holy to us, that we want to do everything we can to protect that sacredness, that consecration, that being separated from everything that is profane, everything that is not of God's holiness. All right. There are in the Holiness Code in Leviticus what we call cultic laws. And the cult has to do with the formal worship. So for us, Mass is a cultic occasion. Because it's formal worship. Leviticus chapter 1. They shall be holy to their God and not profane the name of their God. For they offer the Lord's offerings by fire, the food of their God. Therefore, they shall be holy. Now, there are all kinds of ways that Israel offered sacrifices to God. So there could be what are called complete burnt offerings, where the grain or the animal or whatever were completely burnt up. And there's good symbolism to that. Like when we offer, that's it. It's a free given, whole and complete. But there was another way they offered sacrifice to God, where the offering wasn't burnt up. In case of meat, I hope it was cooked. But they would actually eat of the offering, eat of the sacrifice. By eating of the sacrifice, they partook in God's holiness. Eating is a powerful symbol. We do it without thinking about it. And unfortunately, the fineness of eating, I'm thinking of how often in families now, a family meal is just unheard of. You know, we're too often getting the kids to soccer or whatever else. And at best, you know, we grab something at McDonald's, which is not eating in my opinion. But what this passage that we can learn from Leviticus is all about is eating is a sacred act. And when we offer a sacrifice for God, like we pray before meals, do you ever really think about the traditional meal prayer? Bless us, O Lord, and these thy gifts. What are we asking of God? Make us holy, O Lord, and make holy these gifts, which we receive from your bounty. Some people like to change that word bounty to goodness, and I don't. Because goodness is nice, but bounty says something much more, doesn't it? which we receive from your bounty for God's absolutely unending gifts to us. Now, what that simple prayer that I don't know about you, but I've been saying since I was probably about 2 years old. I think it's the first prayer I learned. What that says to me is God makes us holy, and God makes the food holy. And as we eat that food, take that food into us, we are consecrating ourselves in that holiness. The prayer could have said, bless the food. But it says, bless us and these thy gifts. Did you ever think about that? Think about that. You know, in blessing us and blessing the food, then by eating, we're kind of doing what Leviticus says. We're eating the food of the sacrifice. And by eating that food, we're communing with God. It's not insignificant that the greatest of our sacraments involves eating and drinking. But the eating and drinking is a food none of our making, is it? God takes the work of our hands and the gift of the earth and transforms them into the very divine Son that we eat and drink. And in that eating and drinking, what happens? We're taking in God's essence. Every time we commune, we are eating God's holiness and becoming that holiness. That's the great mystery of the Eucharist. That's the great thing that God gives us. That Jesus' own self-giving is so constant, so eternal. I was with a friend not too long ago who said to me, I just get so excited when I'm going to Mass. I can't wait until communion. And I've thought of that so often the last few weeks. I'm thinking, I need to do better about getting excited about going to Mass. I need to do better about getting excited about receiving Holy Communion. Because I'm receiving God's very life. I'm receiving God in the person of the second person of the Trinity, the Divine Son. That's another mystery we can think about the rest of our life. Leviticus 23, speak to the people of Israel and say to them, these are the appointed festivals of the Lord. Now we're getting to the real cultic occasions. Here are the festivals that you celebrate, that you shall proclaim as holy convocations. So they're not just ha-ha things. They're holy convocations. That word convocation is interesting. Convocation to convoke. Vocare means to speak. So again, our holy convocations are at the invitation of God. God has ordained these festivals. God has determined these festivals. We might shape them, but essentially they belong to God and they are of God. So Israel has a lot of festivals. Pesach, the Feast of Booths, Yom Kippur, and we Christians have a lot of festivals. Christmas, Easter, Pentecost, Christ the King, and a bunch of them in between. You know, these are holy convocations where we come together. And why do we come together in joy and celebration? Because God is sharing with us in these cultic occasions God's very holiness, God's very self. All right, thirdly, there are ethical laws, good and bad, right and wrong laws. Leviticus 18, I am the Lord your God. You shall not do as they do in the land of Canaan, as others do, as pagans do, to which I am bringing you. You shall not follow their statutes. My ordinances you shall observe. My my statutes you shall keep, following them by doing. By doing so, one shall live. I am the Lord. By following the ordinances, the commands, the festivals that God has given us, we live. Could we live without our sacraments? We might live a human life without our sacraments, but everything we've been talking about here is far more than human life, isn't it? We can't live the shared divine life without these gifts that God has given us. Next, Leviticus 22. Thus you shall keep my commandments. So law is important. You know, following God's will is important. And observe that I am the Lord. Look how often, it's a good Latin exercise, read the book of Leviticus, but most of it's pretty boring. Even 17 to 26 is pretty boring when they go through all these laws and all the laws, huh? But go through and look how often God says something and says, I am the Lord. That's kind of the whole key to understanding the whole book of Leviticus in my mind. I am the Lord, which basically says, all this is about bringing you into me. I am the Lord, I am the Lord, I am the Lord. Come, 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 come. You shall not profane my holy name, that I may be sanctified among the people of Israel. To take God's name in vain is not to acknowledge the sanctity, the holiness that is the essence of God. I am the Lord. Here we go again. I am the Lord. I sanctify you. I make you holy. I brought you out of the land of Egypt. There's that separation. There's that consecration. There's that election. I brought you out of Egypt. You didn't do it on your own. On your own, you would have headed back. I brought you out. I brought you to this wonderful land. It's all my doing. All you have to do is follow along. Sometimes thinking is great, but just keep that line on. I brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God, to be your holiness that you can share with me. I am the Lord. Only the Lord can do it. All right, now we're going to look at the New Testament. Jesus is holy. Well, that's a no-brainer. You know, we don't think about that much, do we? Jesus, bless you. Jesus is just Jesus. But Jesus is holy. Why? Because Jesus is God. So if we affirm God is holy, then we're affirming that Jesus is holy. Luke 1, chapter 35. The whole, now he's talking, we're talking about Mary. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, Mary, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He shall be called the Son of God. So what the angel Gabriel is revealing to Mary at the Annunciation is this isn't any ordinary baby. It's certainly not conceived in the ordinary way. It's by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now here we have an interesting reversal, don't we? We said the Holy Spirit is generated by the love of the Father and the Son. Now it's the Holy Spirit's love that is enabling the Son to become human. That's an interesting twist, isn't it? It's the very love of the Father and the Son that generates the Holy Spirit, but it's by the Holy Spirit, this life-giver, it's by the Holy Spirit that Jesus is able to become human. And what does it mean for Jesus to become human? It's to show us a whole new phase of how God calls us to be holy. Because now, by taking on human flesh, by taking on everything that we are, that is really, in a sense, alienated from God, by taking on actually everything except sin. So Jesus wasn't excluded from suffering. He wasn't excluded from death. He wasn't excluded from betrayal. He wasn't excluded from ridicule. You know, excluded from all the negatives about this human condition which we share. He took all of that on. He understood us. So that was part of the readings from last Sunday, the second reading. Jesus understood us because he was human. He lived what we live. He lived what we live. So last Sunday's gospel about the money changers, when the gospel writer said Jesus was angry, he wasn't kidding. He wasn't kidding. Jesus was really angry. And it was a righteous anger, wasn't it? What was happening in God's temple was not intended to be happening because it was no longer holy. There was a denial of the very meaning of this presence of God to the people of Israel. Of course, Jesus should be angry. Well, that presents all kinds of opportunities for us, doesn't it? When we look around and see so much that is not of God, we too ought to have a righteous anger. A righteous anger. John 17, Jesus is praying, Holy Father. In Jesus' prayer to his Father, he's acknowledging who his Father is and who he is. Holy Father. This is the prayer for the disciples. Protect them in your name. Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. To be one together and together in the body of Christ is basically the deepest Christian sense of what it means to share in God's glories. We share as we are made members through baptism of the body of Christ. We are made sharers in God's holiness. Next point. We, who are the body of Christ, are holy. We, who are the body of Christ, are how can we be other? To be the body of Christ, to be baptized into this identity, is to be baptized into Jesus Christ. And by being baptized into Jesus Christ, we share in the very identity of God. Wow. Romans chapter 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. We give ourselves over, holy and acceptable to God. When are we holy and acceptable to God? When we are faithful. When we do God's will. When we do as Jesus did, here I am, Father. Here I am, Father. While I want you to take this cup away from me, that was a deep prayer on Jesus' part in the agony. Father, take this cup away. I don't have anything to do. I don't be crucified. I'm not nuts. But not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. That's how we are holy. By making Jesus' prayer our own prayer. Not my will, but yours be done. From the letter to the Colossians. As God's chosen ones, we are just as chosen as the people of Israel in the Old Testament. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. Does that not describe Jesus? And Mary? And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. To which indeed you were called in the one body, and be thankful. And be thankful. How often in our personal prayer, do we ever thank God for our holiness? do it very often. Because I don't think about it often enough. But here the writer of the letter to the Colossians is saying, and be thankful. Be thankful for who God has made you. Be thankful for how God has called you. Be thankful for all God has done for you. Well, be thankful could be a prayer for the rest of our life. All right, I want to make a switch. And this is kind of like playing a little bit, but I want to draw a parallel between the Holiness Code of Leviticus and what I want to call the Holiness Code of the Eucharist. Now, this is my book. You're not going to find this in the Catechism. But I kind of got intrigued by the parallels between the book of Leviticus and the Holiness Code in that book and what's happening in Eucharist with us. So let's call it the Holiness Code of the Eucharist. If any of you object to that phrase, you can leave now. And I want to kind of run a parallel to those three things where we talk about the religious laws, the cultic laws, and the ethical laws. I want to run a parallel between how the Eucharist is calling us to those three areas. You understand where I'm going? All right, let's look at what I'll call the religious inclination of the Eucharist. Let's look at the introductory words. There are some choices that the presider has in greeting us at the very beginning of Mass. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. What is the grace? The holiness? Huh? God's life. We looked last week. What is grace? God's life. And what is God's life? God's holiness. Alright? Interchangeable words, if you will. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. Communion means one with. One with. The opening words of Mass, the opening invitation of Mass, is to surrender, to be one with, to give yourself over to the amazing thing that God is going to be doing for us during this little bit of time. Then sometimes at Mass we do confidio. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned. And when this new translation came out, I just railed against that phrase. I'm not a great sinner, God. Quit shoving this down my throat. I gotta do some bad things once in a while. But I'm not a great sinner, and I'm sure I'm gonna go to hell. Well, I wasted my life. So I really puzzled because I had to teach this. I mean, how can I teach that we're great sinners? And then I finally had a breakthrough when I was reading some of John of the Cross, you know, the great mystic. And then I started looking at some other of the great mystics, and it struck me how most of the mystics think of themselves as great sinners. Now, that's not encouraging to me. You know, if the mystics aren't making it, I'm not going to make it. So I did some more thinking. Now remember, religion means relationship, to bind to, religio. Isn't it true in our lives that the more we love someone, the more husband and wife fall in love with each other? Isn't it true that even the little tiny things we might do to upset the other bothers immensely? In the early stages of a relationship, you can upset, you know, your beloved and probably not even realize it because you don't know each other well enough. But isn't it true as we grow in our relationship with another, as we grow in our love for another, even the little tiniest ways that we might offend the other become big things for us because we don't want to offend the other? You catch a lot of what I'm saying? So here's the irony to me in this love relationship we have with God. The more we love God, the more we grow in holiness, the more aware, the greater are we, the more aware are we of our great sinfulness. Now, not sinfulness in that we're doing big bad things. Sinfulness in the sense that any little thing that weakens us, our relationship with God, looms big to us. Because as we grow in our relationship with God, the beauty of what God gives us in that relationship, the joy, the wonder of the presence of God to us, we don't want to do anything that diminishes that. Right? Follow me? You hear what I'm saying? So now I pray that can feed you in a whole new light. Because when I sin, I confess to Almighty God that I have sinned. I'm not talking about big things. I'm becoming aware of any little tiny thing that weakens my relationship with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Because that's the witness to my relationship with God. Oops. Oops. We don't love God in the abstract. We love God in the very concrete of our relationships with each other. So anything I do to harm my relationship with God, you know, I'm home from work and I'm tired, and the kids come to me and want help or something, and I just go away. You know, as I reflect on that, that hurts, doesn't it? That's not how I should say or respond to that child. Often I hear, back when I was teaching high school, one of the adolescent's biggest heartaches is mom and dad don't listen to me. And what they're saying there is not just hearing the words, they're not listening with the heart. Now, listening to teenagers doesn't mean we agree with them 99.9% of the time. But to listen to a teenager, to have compassion on them as we try to help them grow, is growing in holiness. Is growing in holiness. It's not insignificant that after we have the penitential act, at Mass, except during Lent and Advent, what do? We rise in a crescendo with the glory to God in the highest. We sing the glory. It's like once we kind of clear the air with what separates us from God, we can't help but burst in that great hymn of glory. Not this Sunday, you're not going to hear the glory. Easter, when you hear the glory for the first time in 7 weeks, pay attention to the words. We know these words of the Mass so much that we tend not to tune them out. And what we need to do is bring ourselves to pay attention to what we're saying. Glory to God in the highest. And peace on earth. Not that we got anything but peace right now. When are we going to have peace? When all of us start paying more attention to our holiness. And while all of us receive our holiness in terms of not my will, but yours be done. That's when we'll have peace. So these words of our Eucharistic celebration have tremendous implications. I've always said we need to leave Eucharist different, or we do leave Eucharist different. The question is, what do we do about it? What do we do about it? From the Collect, the opening prayer of the Solemnity of the Annunciation of the Lord, March 25th. And this year, because Holy Week is there, it's going to get transferred to the Monday after the second Sunday of Easter. And that doesn't compute, because that's going to be April 9th. And then Mary and Jesus' birthday should have been January 9th. We've got to get that 99 months in there perfect. You see, March 25th to December 25th, you're thinking about that is 9 months. You know, Mary was very regular. So was Elizabeth. Oh, God. When you start getting into the lectionary and these mass prayers, it's amazing what's couched in all this stuff. It's fun. O God, who willed that your word should take on the reality of human flesh. on all the parts. In the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary, grant, we pray, that we who confess our Redeemer to be God and man, to be divine and human, may merit to become partakers in his divine nature. May merit to become partakers in his, even in his divine nature. I'm going to go a little overtime, so if anybody needs to leave at 1, you at 11 o'clock, you're not going to offend me, but I don't want to just skip the rest of it, okay? Because the divine Son took on human flesh, it opened the door for us to be partakers in the divine. Which is to say, it opened the door for us to be holy. Our journey of life is about becoming divine. In the Eastern Church, there's a doctrine about this, and the doctrine is called theosis. T-H-E-O-S-I-S. Theo is the Greek word for God. And anytime you add S-I-S onto the end of a Greek word, it means the state of being. So what the doctrine of theosis means is the state of being God. What the Eastern Church is saying, our whole life is about moving toward our human death when we become divine, when we become absolutely one with God. That's the kind of holiness that God desires in us. Preparation of the gifts. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. We hear those words, where we could pray them, there's half the time we're singing. But those words are said at every single Mass. May we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. And then the response to the prayer linked to the invitation of the gifts. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands. I'm hearing some priests now change that to R. And I think those, I would go crazy if priests change words. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at, no, I'm sorry, we're saying this, at your hands. But the your now is not the priest doing the offering. I've talked to this before many times here. Who's doing the offering? Christ. The priest is the visible presence of Christ. But when we say your, we're talking to Christ. It's Christ's offering of himself to which we bind ourselves. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Every time we say these words, we're pronouncing ourselves to be holy. So the challenge is, do we believe it? Do we live it? Do we live the not my will, but yours be done? The liturgy of the Eucharist. This is for the most of all, it's from the second Eucharistic prayer. You are indeed holy, O Lord, is how the prayer begins after the breakfast. The fount of all holiness. Beautiful phrase, isn't it? The fount of all holiness. Well, fount implies spilling forth, doesn't it? Gushing forth. Well, Where's God's holiness gushing forth? To us. To us. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Holy Spirit upon them like the dewfall. What's the source of our holiness? The Holy Spirit who dwells within us. And the Holy Spirit who comes down upon these gifts. Further on, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who transforms the bread and the wine into the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ? The Holy Spirit. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to stop. Next one. Give thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence. And we're not worthy on our own. God calls us to that worthiness. And then after the institution, is humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, and as we share in communion with the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. What does it mean to be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit? To be gathered into the body of Christ. To be gathered into God's very holiness. Wow. The cultic impulse, remember the worship impulse, the liturgy of the Eucharist. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. I get so frustrated when I hear assemblies at Mass, the preface, it's called the preface dialogue. The Lord be with you, not with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord. That's righteous. You're laughing, but you know, doggone, what we don't think about this, do we? Now, I want to go back to the Latin. Lift up your hearts as sursum corda. Okay, sursum, up. Corda, hearts. Now we got your hearts properly, huh? Now our response, we got that all wrong. For all of our care about the translation, this is not right. Not even close to being correct. We didn't do it, we couldn't figure out how to do it. There's no verb for lift them up at all in that habemus adominum. Habemus is the first person plural. We have them understood to the Lord. Sursum means on high, hearts. So if this were really the correct Latin to English exchange, what Father would say is hearts on high. And what we say is we've got them up there. What's really going on in that incredibly beautiful exchange is we're saying, you know, just as we're beginning this Eucharistic prayer, our hearts are where they're supposed to be. Our hearts are with God. Our hearts are spilling out with holiness. And then what's going to happen is tremendous. It's more you can think about. Let's move on. After that, after the preface, what do we sing? We looked at it earlier. What was happening in Isaiah is called Holy, 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 Lord God of Hosts. When I was a kid, I thought that meant all those things in the assembly. Host is the heavenly host. It's an army of those singing praise to God. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Heaven and earth are Shekinah. Heaven and earth are full of your presence. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. We say right before our word, the invitation to communion. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. In Revelations 19:9, where this comes from, the actual quote is, blessed are those who have been called to the wedding feast of the Lamb. I wish they'd kept the scripture quote accurate. What's happening? We're at a wedding feast. Isn't that a beautiful image? And what's the wedding about? Christ and us. Christ is the spouse of the church and we're the church. Communion ought to be an incredibly joyful perichoresis because we're celebrating our marriage with the Lamb. We're celebrating our oneness with God. We're celebrating God's call to us for holiness. Then it would seem as though we have a little bit of a letdown because it's misunderstood. Lord, I am not worthy. It's like slapping God in the face. But again, we have to take that phrase and put it in the gospel context. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. But only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Now, this is the centurion coming to Jesus. You know, asking that his servant be healed. And when Jesus starts to come, he says, his servants actually, no, you're too holy. You're too good. All you need to do is say the word. All right, so what we're saying before we have received communion is the word only needs to speak, but now this is this word with a capital W. The word made flesh. And why are we healed? Because we're eating and drinking of the very essence of the divine. We're eating and drinking the very body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Ethical impetus, liturgy of the word, the homily. If it's a good homily, it should make us warm. Because what the homily does is take those scripture readings that have been proclaimed, and the homily should be in your face about what those readings are calling us to. And those readings are calling us to a change in our life. They're calling us to become even more holy. The universal prayer, the prayer of the faithful. When we pray for the church, for the salvation of the world, for the sick and those in need and for our own community, what are we praying for? We're ultimately praying for the kind of healing that can only come as we embrace our holiness. And then the dismissal. Go and announce the gospel, the good news of the Lord. That doesn't mean stand on the street corner. What that really says is go and do, not my will, but yours be done. Because the more we do God's will, the more like God we become. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. Remember, glory is God's presence. Every time we do, not my will, but yours be done, we are making visible God's presence. That's a great call to do the right thing, isn't it? The good we do is the visible presence of the divine. That's a great motivator. That's a great motivator. Some questions. I'm not going to go through all of them because I want to throw open for questions. The first one. How do I first think of myself? As a sinner or as a holy person? And my experience is the vast majority of times we first think of ourselves as sinners. And everything about Scripture and everything about our celebration of the sacraments is about we are holy. We are God's beloved. We are called to be one with God. You can look at those other questions on your own. For these last weeks of Lent. Sunday is Laetare Sunday. You know, where the priest can wear robes because in the olden times when the penance and the fasting and everything was a lot more strict, we could kind of, we're going to make it. You know, we got a big chunk of it over. Laetare Sunday, joyful Sunday, is not about getting through Lent. Church sets these weeks aside for us to ask ourselves, am I growing in God's holiness? I invite you during these last weeks of Lent to think less about sin and more about God's gift of holiness. I invite you to raise your hearts in prayer of gratitude, thanksgiving, awe, wonder, adoration for what God has given us. What holiness is about is our God invites us into divine life. It's all God has. The only thing God has is holiness. That's it. That's God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Amen. audience answer questions. Those who need